good to be back to see you again. And I look forward to the time Bill Stump invited me back. And it's always good to come and talk to people who see. Now, for 50 years I was an ordained minister, and I had churches generally everywhere in the Midwest, but couldn't see. I ain't talking about out of my eyes, right, like it's here. I couldn't see. Now, I'm going to give you my testimony, and I'm going to blend it into my little message today. All right, so I'm going to pray first. Let's just bow heads.
Before we pray, there's a special prayer request I'd like to pray for.
Okay.
My brother's online from Australia. His wife, Margaret, has been recently diagnosed with breast cancer. She's not a believer.
Okay.
And so we want to pray for her physically, but most importantly, spiritually. Her name is Margaret in Australia.
Margaret. Yes. Okay.
She's the wife of Brother Michael.
All right. Excuse me for not getting on my knees, but let's just bow heads. Lord, we're thankful again to come quietly aside and to go into your word and hear the testimonies. And Lord, as we are here this evening and tomorrow, be with us in a special way. Now remember Sister Margaret way down in Australia. Lord, touch her body as you can do and heal it and make her whole. Bless us this evening. May we all get a blessing that we can actually work with and see you. And when Jesus should return, save us in thy kingdom, we ask for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Amen.
So now everybody had a testimony. I had one too, but I wasn't going to talk it, but I'm going to give you my testimony anyhow. Now, come on in, you folks, and have a seat.
Everything's a good seat, especially the ones up front. Dennis, come over here and get me right here.
Now, there's three people that had a profound effect on me seeing. And two of them, Brother and Sister Cox, were the first ones that put something in my head. See, the Lord has a way of working with you, and sometimes it takes longer to get things through your skull than others, you know. So, Brother and Sister Cox were the first ones. 1976, they wanted to join the Allegheny West Conference. So the conference president asked me to come and go down to Newark with them.
Now, why would that be unusual for those who may not understand?
Well, now, Elder Cleveland was one who didn't want any members basically in the conference who were offshoots or distant people or destructive. They didn't want nobody to bring noise in and fuss and all that. So he wanted me to go with him, go down to check these folks out to see if they'd come in. So that particular day that we went in to check, they were talking about the Holy Spirit. And so of course they told us about the Holy Spirit, about the Godhead, and all this idea with the Trinity. So when we left, they said, okay. So now I put that way back in my head. The Lord wouldn't let me forget that. So years went by. That was 76. So in 1984, they sent me to the Glenville Church in Cleveland. And so the first baptism I had was Willis Smith.
Oh, yeah.
See, you all know Willis Smith. See, I baptized Willis Smith. So I left Cleveland, Willis Smith left Cleveland, and so we didn't hear from each other for a long time. So then Willis Smith started writing the conference. He said, all you conference folks need to understand about God and this Trinity thing, you see, and wrote the conference president, and the president said, oh, we don't want to hear nothing about him, so He wrote me a letter, and so I wrote him a letter that I found out just recently, where I told him, okay, brother, won't you go on to the seminary and learn like I did, and you got a GI Bill and all that. Well, that was back in about 88 or 89. So back in my head. So I ain't seeing. So then in 89, I came down. I was in the conference secretary, and I came down, and I visited all the churches in the conference. And one of them especially I visited, and I really fell in love with it. And guess where it was? In Kimball. Kimball, West Virginia. Never seen it, never heard of it, didn't know anything about Kimball. So I walked in the church, nobody was in there, but but Henry Robinson.
Yeah.
That's Brother Robinson. So Robinson says, oh, you know, we're down here and we're looking for this and we're looking for that. So he said, you know, there's some Adventists up the road. And the man up there, he helped build this church. And he said, but you know, there was some fuss up there or something, and the church up there left and they divided it off, and so I didn't think to put it back in my head. So I ain't seeing. So then I left the conference in 1997. So between that time, the World Church was celebrating the 150th year of 1844. So wrote a whole lot of books about the church and how it was founded and what it was founded on and some of the foundations of the church. And they had all that. So I read every book from George Knight, and I read M.L. Andreessen, and I read all about C. Mervyn Maxwell. I said, well, you know, this is a strange thing. All these men back there understood the purpose of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and I haven't been doing that. I haven't been teaching about that. Didn't see. So in walks the second man in the church in Columbus, Bob Diener. You all know him. I didn't know Diener from nobody. Comes into my church, and we were studying on the Steps to Christ. So he takes out of his book and plops it on my desk. He said, have you seen this? I said, no. I said, your book is just like mine. He said, no, it's not. He said, this book was printed by some publishers in Chicago. That didn't hit too well, because I thought the Review and Herald published it. So he said, no, he gave me the history behind it. Still didn't dawn on me. So Brother Diener came to my central church every Wednesday night, and every Wednesday night he came, he brought a book. And about the third time, he brought Foundation by Stump. But he just brought it to my desk and he just plopped it down. And I said, where'd you get this? He said, well, you just check it out. So I leafed it through, turned the page, and I saw Alan Stump. Welch, West Virginia. I said, wait a minute now. Welch is down there by Kimball. I said, that's the same man that Henry Robinson told me about. How in the world did he write a book? So then Brother Dean said, listen, what I did, now, Brother Dean was giving me all these things that he'd gotten from the archives archives of General Conference, and he brought them to his house. So he said, well, you know, one day, I said, my Brother Stump came up to my house with a copy machine. And he copied all the material. He said, I didn't care. So he went back and wrote this book. Still didn't catch it. So I didn't say nothing. I just kind of was dumbfounded. But what it did, it alerted me to the fact that for all these years, I hadn't seen. I had eyes in my head, but it didn't see. So then I said, I'm going to meet Brother Stump. So I came back to Kimball, came back and met Alan Stump. See, now sometimes, and I'm not giving anybody any praise or honor or any glory, But I have to tell you that Alan Stump, see, I don't know who else tells it like I'm going to tell it. Alan Stump is going to show, has shown me something, and if you read what he writes, he'll show you something. Now, I don't know how in the world that man puts out the newsletter that he does, all the information, and it illustrates, see, there are illustrations in there that expose truths. So I'm encouraging you to get on his list, and when he sends you something, read it.
Amen.
Alan Stump. So what I did was, I went and called the archives at the General Conference, and I said, who can look at these archives? He said, well, anybody can look at the archives. All you got to do is just come on up and we'll let you in. But he said, but not Alan Stump.
Wait a minute.
I said, wait a minute. Now, why not Alan Stump? So I said, I want to ask him, but I said, no, I don't want him to brand me so I won't come. So I didn't say nothing. So whatever impression was made, Brother Alan Stump put an impression on that man's mind that the truths that he was presenting, they didn't want it out. Now, I say all that to say that whatever is factual for the kingdom, if you're sincere in heart, the Lord won't let you forget it. And he gives people information to help you understand the principles of the kingdom. Now, I got some cards. I want Brother Cox and my wife to give you. I'm going to show you that the Lord knows our minds. See, he knows our minds. And he knows as human beings, we look through our eyes, but even though you're looking, you don't see. And you're hearing and you don't hear. So when you get that card, I want you, whatever you see, what you see on the card, I want you to just hold your hand if you see what's on there. Now, something's on there. Something's on the card. I'm talking about the picture on the front that's writing on the back of it. But whenever you see it, just hold your hand up. Now, I'm going to go to my sermon now. Now, whatever you see on that card, if you see it, just, all right, now, Sister Cox says she sees it. Good. Just hold on to it now. Just hold on to it. And I don't want you to look at it while I'm up here talking, all right? All right, now just hang on to it. Now just kind of look at it and just observe it and see what you see. And I'm going to read to you. Now, take your Bibles and turn to Matthew 13. See, this shows me the importance of Elder Stump. See? Now, you don't see that yet, but I'm going to show you. All right, Matthew 13. And I'm going to read for you, and I'm going to just talk to you. Matthew 13. Now, Sister Cox is the only one who raised her hand and said she saw what she saw. All right? Oh, you saw it? Okay, hold on now. Hold on, hold on. Okay, hold it. Just a minute, hold it. All right? Matthew 13, and I'm going to read verse 1. And the same day, went Jesus out of the house and sat by the seaside. And great multitudes were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a ship and sat. And the whole multitude stood on the shore. Okay, get the picture now. The disciples were with Jesus. But then a whole lot of other people came and sat on the shore while Jesus went out into the boat. And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went forth to sow. Now, Everybody back there then knew what a sower was. Do you know what a sower is? A sower is somebody who goes and plants seeds in the ground. Okay, now I'm going to skip down. There was a sower that fell, the seed fell by the wayside, verse 4. And then some fell on the stony places, verse 5. And then down to verse 7, some seeds fell among thorns. And the thorns sprang up and choked them, verse 8. But another fell upon good ground and brought forth fruit, and some a hundredfold, some 60-fold, and some 30-fold. Now here's the story that Jesus was giving them, illustrations. Parables are illustrations that Jesus was giving. Apparently because the people were looking, but they couldn't see. Hold it now, let me show you. Verse 9. Who has ears to hear, let him hear. Now you mean to tell me they were listening to Jesus and wasn't hearing it? See, this was me. See, I'm listening and I'm looking, but I'm not seeing and I'm not listening. And lately, everything I talk about, I'm talking about me, really. See, and it could be talking about you. No, really. Yeah, it could be talking about you. You're looking in just like I was looking, but I ain't seeing nothing. See, now, all this that I was shown, didn't see. See, but the Lord, with mercy, shown me. All right? Who has ears to hear, let him hear. Now, why would Jesus say that? Somebody ain't listening. Somebody not hearing. Then verse 10 says, and the disciples came and said unto him, why speakest thou unto them in parables? He said, he answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you to know what? The mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. But to them it is not given. In other words, Jesus spoke in parables or illustrations to show the multitude hidden treasures of his kingdom. Pretty good, isn't it? I thought, being a preacher, I'm knowing all about the kingdom. Oh, I've been a preacher, been with the Andrews, been taught at the university, went through Oakwood College. So I'm seeing. I thought I didn't see. Jesus comes along and he illustrates something for me here. Just like you. You read the Bible, you read this, you read that. But are you seeing? Are you hearing? Now listen to what he says now. To him, Jesus, what I've learned is, I'm learning to take more heed of what I find Jesus saying. See, Jesus has given me keys to his kingdom, and that's where I'm interested in going. So I want to read every word he gives me very carefully to make sure that I'm getting what he's pointing out to me. And in verse 13, for whosoever hath to him, 12, yeah. For whosoever hath, to him shall be given. And he shall what?
Have more
abundance. But whosoever hath not, from him he taketh away even for what? That he hath. Now let me read this in another translation that's a little bit smoother because I want you to really get this. He replied, you are permitted to understand the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but others are not. Now Seventh-day Adventists have been given the secrets of the kingdom. Seventh-day Adventists have been given hidden truths. Now don't forget that. Seventh-day Adventists have been given the plan of salvation clearly to be understood. But notice what he says, though. To those who listen to my teachings, more understanding will be given, and they will have an abundance of knowledge. Now, the disciples had been given this abundant knowledge, but the other people had not. So he was giving them an illustration of the hidden principles of the kingdom, just like Seventh-day Adventists. And he says now, to you who got this knowledge now, he's going to add on. Let me read on. But for those who are not listening, even what little understanding they have will be taken away from them. Now we got this understanding and we got this wisdom. And the Lord says, now if you don't use it, I'm going to take it away. Now, sad to say, the Seventh-day Adventist Church has forgotten the secrets that God had given them for the kingdom. Forgotten it. And I'm going to tell you why. I may tell you tomorrow. That's the reason why all the meetings that I go to, all the meetings that I was sent to, they never told me or pointed out or how interested it is that the kingdom of God had to do with the sanctuary. Sanctuary? Seventh-day Adventists don't even believe that now. You don't know that? We had one president who said, oh, we don't believe in the sacred no more. We don't believe in that no more. We don't believe in the atonement no more. That is the reason why, but I'm going to tell you that now. Now listen. Verse 13. Therefore spake I to them in parables, because they are seeing, see not, and hearing, they hear not, neither do they understand. See, Jesus is telling us in so many words, you read the Bible, you say your prayers, you go to church, but you're not seeing the hidden things of my kingdom. The hidden things of the kingdom, one of the most important things is the sanctuary that brings the whole complete plan of salvation so you can see it.
Amen.
But we don't see it. We don't hear it. And we don't understand it. We read, we see, but we don't understand. Jesus was telling them a problem that his people already had, always had. So we always have the same problem they had back there. They read, they study, but they don't see and don't hear. So Jesus goes and he quotes Isaiah 9:6. He says, now look, Isaiah, you go and tell them that they hear all these things about me, they see all these things about me, but their mind is dull. That was me. Dull-minded. Couldn't hear, couldn't see, didn't know. That's the condition that we have today.
Is that text Isaiah 6:9?
Isaiah 6:9. Yeah, Isaiah 6:9. See, that's what Jesus quoted. See, he's telling them that. Now, go over to verse 13, 16. But blessed are what? Your eyes. Why are you worrying about somebody's eyes? For they see, and your ears, for they hear. Okay? Now, take that card and tell me what you saw, if you saw anything on it. Did you even look at the card? Have you seen it?
Yeah.
See, now the truths about the scriptures are in the Bible. And you say you've been reading the Bible. It's like you've been looking at that card, but you don't see what you see. It's on there. Now, have you seen it?
I didn't see it.
Oh, is this guy, you got it?
No.
What is it?
It's a goose.
Who saw it?
I saw something.
It's a goose. Oh, what did you see, brother?
Well, I just saw a mother feeding its baby.
A mother feeding its baby. Okay. All right, way back there. Okay, brother.
Jesus sitting in a boat.
Jesus sitting in a boat. Lord have mercy. All right.
That's an actual photograph.
Yeah, that's an actual photograph.
I see mountains.
Now here, now let me give you the point. Now, I showed it to Ella Cox, and I showed it to my wife. Look, now when they tell you what you see, you will see it. See? You say, oh, I didn't know that. I didn't see that. And every time you look at it from now on, you will see what you saw. So Jesus gives us an illustration that he's talking about hidden things of the kingdom, and unless somebody illustrates it to you, you won't see it. And Stump is one that has illustrated to us this whole thing of the atonement, that if you don't read it, you won't see it. Now, take that card and turn the bottom of it to the left. Now, I'm showing you the illustration. Turn it to the left. Turn it to the left. Turn it to the left. See, and once you see it, you say, oh, now I see it. This is what Jesus was doing. He was giving them, I say, oh, they hit you back of the Big Mac truck. Yeah, Ellison, what do you see?
I see a cow.
Oh, see, he sees it. But see,
I'll never miss it again.
That's right, you will never miss it. See, and my wife showed him that. So what Jesus was saying here, I'm giving you an illustration to show you the hidden things of the kingdom because your mind won't let you see it. Now do you see it? Turn to the left and look at it. You see a cow that's looking right at you in your face.
Oh,
yeah. See it? See it? See it?
Okay, illustration of the year.
See now, you see, that's Jesus was talking to me. All these years I've been reading the Bible. All these years I've been praying. All these years I've been preaching. Now, Stump comes along. Now, wait a minute. Now, Stump comes along and illustrates what the Bible has been talking about for years. Now, you see that guy? You don't see it? You see, once you look at it, you'll see it all the time. Every time you pick it up, you'll see that cow. See? And the point being, folk, Jesus gave parables or illustrations of hidden things of the kingdom that we ordinarily don't see. Now the whole thing of the atonement, it's an illustration of how he takes care of sin and how he saves us. But we don't see it. And the sad thing about it is, the people that we look to help us understand have turned our mind from it. I've turned our minds from it. Turned our mind from the Trinity. See, oh, you know, everybody sees Trinity. But when you study the Bible, or if you listen to what Stump writes, you'll see the Trinity. Oh, yeah, I see it now. Clear as day. When you read what Stump writes, you see the sanctuary in all of its phases, clear as day. Sister Hope gave a tremendous discourse today about the sanctuary. See, Stump, for example, is a person who will help you see the hidden treasures of salvation. Now, sad to say, all of us are part and parcel of Satan deceiving the whole world. Do you think the whole world has been deceived? And I used to think I wasn't part of that, but I've been part of it. See, all of us, different ones have been standing up talking about whether you come out of the church, this church, that. Satan has led us to believe that our salvation is wrapped up in where we go. Now the Bible plainly tells me that we should not have any other gods before us. Now Satan has been so successful in placing the corporate church as God.
That's right.
Now, am I telling you the truth? So instead of going to Jesus for your salvation, you go and ask the preacher, or ask the conference, or ask the general conference. Instead of taking the word, digging the word out, and through the word, the Lord will show you and reveal to you the plan of salvation. But we run other places. And Jesus has made it clear that if you're going out of this world, you have to only go out by me. So remember that when you read things carefully, and the most important thing I've discovered is that Jesus gives you the answer to every question. Now, the last thought here, verse 18. Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. Okay? When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not. See, now that's where the catch comes. You hear the word about the kingdom, but you don't understand it. Don't understand it. Oh, yeah, I read my Bible. Oh, I hear what the Bible says. Oh, I go to church every week. Oh, I do all this kind of stuff. But if you don't understand the hidden principles of the kingdom, he says you're just like the man who put the seeds out there and it didn't bring forth no fruit. And here it goes again in verse 23. But he that receiveth seed, the good ground, is that heareth the word, and understandeth it, which also beareth fruit and bringeth forth fruit, and some hundredfold, 60, and some 30. So in other words, the principle that Jesus was trying to lay down was, you have to understand it, and then you have to see it and understand it. Now you read the Bible and you read what it says about the sanctuary. You understand it? You read it. No, I don't understand it. I heard what it said, but I don't get it. You just go right on. He says that's just like reading, don't understand it. And he says up in verse 19 again, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth it away, that which was sown in the heart. This is he which received the seed by the wayside. See, if you don't understand what the Spirit has put in your heart about the kingdom, he says the devil will come and take it away. Now that's sad. Read the Bible, say your prayers every day. You don't understand what you're talking about. Don't understand what you're doing. The devil will sit there and take it. So my advice and encouragement is read what Jesus said more carefully. read what he says more carefully and pray that he gives you understanding about what he's talking about. So you can see with your spiritual eyes what he's doing. Like that cow. See, once you see it, you'll always see it. But you won't see it until somebody shows you what the illustration is. And I'm glad to say, and I've appreciated again, the work of Elder Stump to show us the hidden principles and treasures of the spirit of prophecy and of the Word of God. Let's bow our heads, please. Father in heaven, we thank thee for Jesus who came and shows us everything. We ask, O Lord, that we would look carefully into your word and see the illustrations that tell us about your hidden treasures. Be in our minds, open our minds, help us to understand it, and then help us to obey it. Forgive us for our sins. And again, remember Margaret down in Australia. Touch her with your power and heal her for Jesus' sake. We ask it all in his name. Amen. Amen.
Is there anyone that still hasn't seen the cow yet? did we all see it? No.
Yeah.
Okay. I'd like for us to read John 14 and verse 26. But I'd like to clarify something too. It's true I made the phone call to Elder ST, but I didn't invite him to the camp meeting, except I was the channel the church invited him to the camp meeting. They wanted him to come. And if I'd known he was going to say what he said tonight, some of these things, I probably wouldn't have invited him.
You should close your ears.
But verse 26 tells us, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things.
That's right. That's right.
Now, we know, according to Matthew chapter 28, that it's part of God's plan to use people. There's nothing wrong with that.
That's right.
But ultimately, it's the Spirit of God that will teach us. And the Spirit of God wrote this word. And I want to tell you what. If you want to learn this Bible, I'm going to tell you how you can do this. And I'm going to tell you a real simple plan. Mm-hmm. And I did this plan for 4 years. When I was a young Christian, and it helped to lay a foundation that I have never repented of having. I was a coal porter, and I was selling books like Great Controversy, mm-hmm. The Desire of Ages, Prophets and Kings, Patriarchs and Prophets, Acts of the Apostles. And at that time, we had a little booklet that we sold, or gave with the books when we sold them. And it was a reading plan, how you could read through your Bible and all these books in 4 years, mm-hmm. You know. So you'd read your Bible through, you'd read all these books, and it was a 4-year plan, so it didn't take a lot of your time every day. But I decided there was no reason you couldn't do that every year. And those 4 years I canvassed, I read that Bible through, and I read all those books through every year. And it laid a foundation for me that I've never, ever been sorry to have, I tell you. I've been trying to build on it ever since. And those 5 books, with, of course, a book like Steps to Christ, even the one that came from Revell Publishing. Education, the book Christ Object Lessons, and some of these other great books. As you study them with your Bible, you will gain, we have a little time for testimony, so I'd like to just share another testimony. And some of you have heard this testimony, and I'm just going to make it brief. But I didn't get to go to Oakwood College. Mm-hmm. I didn't get to go to Andrews University. Mm-hmm. But they told me to go to Andrews University. Yeah, right, yeah. They did do that. Because I canvassed, I was able to enter into the ministry work, gospel ministry, preaching ministry work. There's a lot of ministry work. And when I became part of this thing that Brother Henry Robinson said, this disgruntled group and all this stuff going on, when I was looking at issues and trying to find truth, deeper truth, I was getting into trouble with the conference, and so my conference president came down, and we had this little talk one Sunday morning in the church pastor's study at the old Indian Creek Church there.
And he said, you know, if you could just go to Andrews University, there are people there who have the same concerns that you have. And you could bang board with other people and you could discuss these things. And there are teachers there that could teach you and help you and get you straightened out, you know. And I'd like to say that there was probably a time in my life that if it could have worked out that way, I would have treasured that opportunity. I would have treasured an opportunity to have sat under godly men and to have been taught by godly men God's ways. You know, Brother Smith, he had that ministry, God's Word, God's Way. It's a good ministry. And so, anyhow, he says, you know, if you could just go and study with these people, they'd help you. Now, my conference president had been to the seminary. He had his Master's of Divinity degree. Well, I thought he could study. I thought he'd know. And so I said, Elder B, I said, why don't you and me just study the Bible together? And so I couldn't study with you. I'm no theologian. I thought, well, I can study with you. I know the Bible. And he said, well, no, we won't do that. You know, and I thought, well, why not? Why not? Ellen White never went to seminary, but I tell you, she understood the Bible really, really well, didn't she? And God has been pleased to give us the spirit of prophecy as a people, which is a light. It may be a lesser light that leads us to the greater light, but it's something that helps us to look in this Bible and we see that cow. You know? We see that picture so much more clearly because it may only say, orientate the picture this way. You know, because when I first saw the card, I'll be honest, ST, I thought, I need to turn the card. I bet you got to turn the card. But then Jan said, I see it, and she's holding the card straight up and down. I thought, well, I don't have to turn the card. But you know, there's a danger there. Because other people say, well, I see it, but they may not really see it. We think they see it. They say they have the truth.
That's right.
And you know, there's a prophecy in the spirit of prophecy where Ellen White speaks about this very thing. Some say, well, I have the truth. I have a message from God. And she says, and they don't at all. They don't at all. And so, I'm just thankful tonight that if in some way God has used me to help a man that I greatly respect, and I consider myself his inferior in every way except health.
We're not negotiating the Holy Spirit, but we sure appreciate your illustration.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm today is 245 straight days of meeting physical fitness goals.
Okay.
Okay. And that's part of the final atonement, friends, is getting ourselves in line. And where's the sister Lane? There she is. I know she'd like to hear me say that. And eating's a big part of it, but exercising is part of it too. And all these eight laws of health. And I know I fell very, very much on this one that's called rest. And I'm trying to work on that. But we do need to take care of ourselves. We need to think. We need minds that have an ability to grasp and to see these mysteries of the kingdom of God. I mean, I think of all the things that God has given me the privilege to do. I mean, I know it's different for everyone in some ways, but to be a steward of the mysteries of the kingdom of God. I just, you know, there's things in life that I like to do that I think are fun, exciting, adventurous, or whatever, but nothing approaches that. And I stand before you as a man who doesn't have to preach to make a living. I don't have to preach to make a living. And I've lost, I don't know how many hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of dollars in my lifetime because I've preached instead of doing something else. And there's people who think I'm very foolish because of that. But I want to tell you, one day I'm going to walk on a street of gold. You know, they're going to use gold for asphalt where I'm going. And these things that we have that we think are so precious today, we know that the rich people are going to cast their wealth to the moles and the bats someday. It's going to be so worthless. When my son was diagnosed with cancer, when he was 17 years old, and that had been about the same year you came up here. Mm-hmm. The same year you came up here.
First time, yeah.
I learned a lot of lessons. And I've had to relearn some of those lessons I didn't learn them well enough or take them to heart. But I tell you, there's one lesson I learned, and that is that there's nothing, nothing in this world important but people. Nothing is important but people. You know, we get upset because someone hit our new car and they put a dent in it. The car's going to burn up someday. That car's going to rust. That car's going to eventually deteriorate. And what does it matter at that time? You know? Someone spills a drink on my coat and they stain it. So what? It's going to burn up someday. I can get all upset and I can run that person away from God because they put a stain on my coat. And that coat's going to burn someday, but that person can go to heaven. And that's what I want. And I know that I'm not there yet. I know that, and you know it probably far better than I do. But I feel like Paul, that I'm pressing toward the mark. And I feel like Paul when he says that he that hath begun a good work in you will finish it.
That's right.
And he will finish that work in each and every one of us.